We've got a busy program today. We begin with a ceremonial welcome from Prime Minister Modi, and I do thank him for the personal way in which he has engaged with me so far on this visit. And today we will be spending most of the day together, and I thank him for giving me the honour of a ceremonial welcome here to New Delhi. We'll then go on to lay a wreath at Raj Ghat to pay tribute to Mahatma Gandhi, and that will be a very solemn occasion, which it will be my privilege to represent Australia at, to pay tribute to one of the giants of the 20th century. I then have a meeting with the Foreign Minister, Dr. Jaishankar. I welcomed him just a couple of weeks ago at Kirribilli House. We've developed a strong relationship, as he has with our Foreign Minister, Penny Wong, and it will be, I think, the fifth or sixth meeting that I've had with Dr. Jaishankar since I've become the Prime Minister. We then will go to the one-on-one meeting between myself and Prime Minister Modi before the formal Australia-India leadership dialogue that will take place along with some other representatives from our respective governments. There will then be a lunch which will include representatives of the business community who are here. As you know, CEOs of major Australian companies have come to India in recognition of how important the relationship is. This is a country of 1.4 billion people. That's a large market. And when we look at the opportunities which are there, the Australian business community certainly recognise that. And it is good that we're having a lunch in which business people from both sides are able to participate to help build those relationships. This afternoon I'll give an address to the Indian Institute of Technology. That is a major think tank and major institution here in India, and that will be a great privilege for me. I'll be outlining the way forward for our relationship and how we build stronger economic ties, and in particular how we take advantage of our respective governments' move towards clean energy economies and the opportunities that that presents, the opportunities as well in information technology, in taking advantage of our respective comparative advantages that we have as complementary but different economies going forward. This afternoon, after that, I will have a courtesy call on the President of India, and I thank her for that. And then we'll conclude what is a long day with a reception at the Australian High Commission, which will include the business representatives who've travelled to India to be a part of this week's relationship building exercise. I expect today to sign agreements with Prime Minister Modi around the three themes of this visit and the three themes in which we're building relations. Firstly, cultural ties. We saw yesterday the cultural expression through sport, but there are many other ways as well. I must say, I hope the Australian cricket team continue to do well today, and congratulations to Uzi on that fine unbeaten century yesterday, and Cameron Green, of course, begins the day on 49 not out. An amazing achievement for someone who's very new to these conditions here in India. But there are other areas as well, including arts and culture, and we'll have more to say about that after the dialogue takes place today. In economic areas, we will also have agreements, including in clean energy. We think, in particular, in solar, there are enormous opportunities. We have on solar. I spoke to one of the major Indian companies here yesterday, who are looking at billions of dollars of investment in Australia, including the manufacturing of solar panels, something that we've been talking about, something that we want to promote through the National Reconstruction Fund, and I want a future made in Australia. And then the third element, of course, is national security. And yesterday I had the great privilege of being on the first ever aircraft carrier built here in India. Those relations between Australia and India are very important. We'll host the Malabar exercises later this year, and we'll have more to say about that. Hang on, Kevin.
Prime Minister, yesterday on that aircraft carrier, it's based on a Russian design. There were three Russian MiGs fighter jets. It goes to the point of India's relationship over many years with Russia and the position on Ukraine, but I guess more broadly about their view of the world as a non-alignment country. What reassurance or belief do you have that they would be part of any action if push comes to shove alongside other allies?
Well, India, of course, is a sovereign nation, and they develop their relationships with other nations based upon as they see fit. What's important is how we deal as a sovereign nation with friends in our neighbourhood. And India is a friend of Australia. We have an increasingly important relationship which goes to our economic ties, our cultural ties, but also our ties through exercises like the Malabar exercises that will take place later this year. We also have, as part of the announcements as well, we've had the participation of Australian defence personnel here in India and exchange the other way around as well. That builds on the people-to-people relations that we have with India. India is an important democracy. India stands up for democracy, and I think that the relationship is a very positive one.
Say, and you have said throughout this trip a few times, that we share the same democratic values as India. Recently, the BBC offices were raided both here in Delhi and in Mumbai after a documentary that was critical of Prime Minister Modi. Are you concerned about a lack of press freedom in this country, and will you be bringing that up in that bilateral today?
Penny Wong commented on that when she was here as Foreign Minister last week. What I do in dealing diplomatically with people I have relationships with is I have discussions based upon Australia's values, and I'm consistent about that. Australia stands up for press freedom, but India is a great democracy, and to dismiss that is, I think, wrong. India has been and continues to be a democratic nation. We will, where there are differences or issues to be raised, we raise them privately and appropriately.
Prime Minister, you haven't made the announcement yet on this subject, but China's already calling on Australia and the US Britain to try to end the Cold War mentality. I wonder how you explain this project to Beijing. And having declared yesterday that India is a top-tier partner of Australia, what tier is China?
Well, what I say is that we are investing in capability, as we should, but we're also investing in relationships, as we are. It is not a contradictory position. It's a consistent position. We need to ensure that Australia's defence assets are the best they can be, and that we build our capability. At the same time, we need to build relationships. That's what I've been doing. I've been doing that here in India. We're doing that throughout the Indo-Pacific. We've done that as well, improved our relationship with China in recent times as well. I've said consistently that we will need a minimum of 2% of GDP, but I expect that defence spending will increase. We've been saying that consistently, and when people have indeed had rather extraordinary headlines from time to time about small increases in revenue, they need to bear that in mind. We need to make sure that we invest more in our defence. I said we don't just pluck a figure out in order to get a headline in a newspaper. What we do is we'll invest what is needed, and I said that in the Lowy Institute speech that I gave prior to the election, and I've said it ever since.
Prime Minister, just on the trade front, you mentioned just then that you spoke with an Indian company looking to invest big in Australia. I've heard from businesses who are saying that it's relatively easier for Indian companies to invest in Australia, but there's a lot of informal barriers in the other direction. I know you're hoping to accelerate progress on the comprehensive trade deal with India during your talks today. What assurances will you be seeking that those informal barriers will shift so that the trade deal that's on paper can be realised?
But we want to move from the ECTA that's been agreed and went through our processes, came into being last December, to the CECA, the Comprehensive Economic Cooperation Agreement. And what that will mean is that we ensure that there is a smoother flow of economic activity between our two nations. The businesses who are here aren't here because although this is a wonderful country to visit, but they're working. They're here because they see an economic interest in their companies expanding influence here. Companies like the Commonwealth Bank are talking about 500 people working at Belengaroo, and there are a range of businesses will be investing. That's why they're here.
Prime Minister, getting back to Kieran's question at the beginning on security in India, we're cooperating with them on the Malabar exercises. They're going to be part of Talisman Sabre. You were on an aircraft carrier yesterday. They're part of the Quad, which is a dialogue, not a particular agreement or alliance. Do you see a day where Australia could then deepen this relationship? That seems to be what Prime Minister Modi wants, to deepen the relationship with China. Does that mean, in your eyes, something like a defence agreement that is more formal on defence and security bilaterally between Australia and India?
Look, what we're doing is building up our relations between our two nations. And these issues are, I think, should be viewed on their merits rather than down the track. That's how you build confidence as well in each other. I now have met with Prime Minister Modi four times, well, more than four meetings, but four separate occasions. In the first year of my Prime Ministership, I will welcome Prime Minister Modi to Australia in the first half of this year for the Quad Leaders meeting. I'll be back here in September for the G20, and then Prime Minister Modi has also invited me yesterday to undertake another bilateral visit to other regions in India at the end of the year. I'll just take a couple of really quick ones. I might take all the questions and then, because I've got to go to that.
Back again briefly, Prime Minister, on the issue of Russia and Ukraine. Analysts say that India is probably best placed of all countries in the world to possibly help broker some sort of solution because of its links to Russia, longstanding, but also obviously with the West. Do you share that assessment? And what will your message to Prime Minister Modi be on that today,
okay,
please?
Thanks, Pete. Just back on AUKUS to pick up the dancing. How soon after the announcement on Monday, how soon will that agreement actually be activated? Will we start to see money in the budget from May for AUKUS programs? But we haven't seen that yet.
Going back to economics, how long, how optimistic should we be about a timeline for the next level of trade agreement? Is progress moving now, or have we waited a bit before we see the real thing?
Thanks, James. On Ukraine, our position on Ukraine is very clear and very consistent, and we raise it privately in the same way we raise it publicly. The struggle of the people of Ukraine is a struggle for the international rule of law and for sovereign states to be able to exist within their boundaries without seeing a brutal illegal invasion, which is what we've seen from Russia. And we continue to have that position. On the budget, I don't want you to have nothing to do and put your feet up between now and the budget. So we've made a range of announcements. So out of my concern for you, I would say that wait till you see what's in the budget. But we've made it very clear when we speak about the pressures that are on the budget that one of the areas is defence. So I say to the coalition that seem to oppose everything as well, I'll have more to say that almost straight into domestic issues. This does have to be paid for. You know, the defence of our country is a solemn responsibility of government, and it is one that I take seriously. This is an investment in our security, and we will do what is necessary to keep our country secure. On the progress on the economy, I see that will move very quickly. I would like to see the comprehensive agreement agreed, in principle at least, by the end of this year. And it is something that I'm pursuing. It's something that has, I think, been assisted, and I want to thank the businesses, be they the 34 businesses in clean energy or the 27 CEOs and university leaders and other leaders of institutions who've travelled here as well. That is sending a big, big message to India that we believe that India matters and that we want to build the relationship. Thanks very much. I'll see you during the day.